Hey, if you're a first-time listener to The Self-Made Theory, then great to have you here. My name is Ben Campbell, and I'm the CPO. What does that stand for? The Chief Podcast Officer for The Self-Made Theory. If you're a regular listener in one of our 60-plus countries where our subscribers are, then welcome back. Now onto the episode. I'm not really into super high-end fashion. I've probably not really understood it well enough before now, but I tell you, this is one of the most fascinating interviews that I've done. I talked to Paul Vasileff, who founded Paolo Sebastian, a couture atelier that has collaborated with the likes of Disney and dressed people like Heidi Klum, Poppy Delevingne, Katy Perry, Kim Kardashian. You get the picture. His work is stunning. In this interview, we talk about how being the very best in your field, perfection may well be the pursuit that will take you there, and how to move from being a solopreneur to hiring your first employee, and how to make that work if you're a perfectionist. And for all you Year 12 listeners out there, think hard and fast about the research project that you're putting forward. It may just launch you into an international career working with the stars. My name is Ben Campbell, and this is The Self-Made Theory. Paul, welcome to The Self-Made Theory.
Thank you for having me.
We are here in your global headquarters here in Adelaide.
Yes.
It's actually the nicest place I've recorded a podcast.
Oh, really? Oh, thank you.
Sorry to all my other guests, but it is pretty fancy in here.
Thank you. Well, that's kind of what we go for. I mean, we have a lot of people flying in from all over the world, so it needs to be a place where they can feel comfortable and, I guess, feel that they're away from the city and, yeah, the world.
Yeah, it's its own little world in here. It's really lovely.
Thank you.
So, give me the elevator pitch.
Okay. Well, I guess Paolo Sebastian is really, first and foremost, it's a couture brand. It's about quality and craftsmanship. And I guess the purpose really of what we do is to give our clients and give people in general a sense of a dream and hopefully inspire them to, I guess, not only, you know, want to feel amazing, but have an appreciation for the art and craftsmanship of couture and couture sewing. You know, these are not dresses that are able to be, you know, purchased just ready to wear off a rack. They're custom made for you. So, the process in making the dress or the garment is just as important as the finished product. Initially, I don't think I knew in the beginning that this would be the brand would get to where it is. I mean, that was always the goal.
That was actually my next question, because often we, you know, as founders, people don't start out with that vision in mind. They start out with some other reason. What started it for you?
I definitely had this vision from, and even the vision isn't even there yet. It's definitely been the same vision since I was 10,
yeah,
maybe younger. So, I get asked quite often, am I surprised that we are where we are? And no, I'm not surprised at all. I'm grateful, but certainly this was part of the grand plan of it. And it's kind of, you know, the finer details, I had no idea, because I had no idea about the fashion industry at all.
Hmm.
But overall, it's kind of where I expect it to be going, because I had no other option or no other backup plan. And I always said, I want to be based here in Adelaide, and I want to give Australia what we see in Europe and in the rest of the world. And I always thought it was such a shame that women from Adelaide used to have to go interstate or overseas to go shopping. And now we have people from Europe and all over the place flying down here to Adelaide and spending time here in Adelaide. And they all comment what a great city it is. And I'm just really proud of that. And that is sort of a byproduct. I mean, it's something that was always really important to me, but I didn't realize how proud it would make me feel that people were coming to my state and realizing what a great place it is. Because when I was starting out, everyone was telling me, no way in hell will you be able to be a fashion designer, especially in Adelaide.
Did that spur you on? Did that?
Yeah,
did
it kind of, I think, gave me that fuel to, oh, I'll show you. I'll do it.
I love that attitude. It's brilliant.
And it wasn't in a spiteful sort of sense. It was just in the sense of, oh, I think I can do it. And even if I don't, I love the work. And if you can call it work, I mean, for me, it's just something that I love doing. So, it doesn't really feel like work. So, if I stay in my parents' lounge room working on the floor as my cutting table, I don't care. I'm still doing, I would have at least tried. And it's like you look at any person that is successful. You look at McDonald's or Disney or any, you know, these big companies, they all had to start from somewhere. And people thought Walt Disney was crazy when he did Snow White, but you look at Disney now.
Exactly.
So, I think everything has to start somewhere. And I'm just grateful that I had the support behind me of my family and my friends and continue to have that support to push me forward and keep going.
Mm.
And the state really got behind me. The local community, they're the reason that we're here. And it's just as much their story as it is mine, really.
So, how do you run a global client base from Adelaide? I mean, do they fly in only? Like, how do you get new clients? How do you work with them?
It was sort of like a slow process starting off because we kind of did one step at a time. And keep in mind, you know, for the first couple of years, it was just me running the business. And I had, you know, a little bit of help from my parents and things, you know, where they could help me. But majority of it was me doing the designing, the cutting, the sewing, the appointments, the bookkeeping, the everything, the answering all the emails and all these things. So,
there'll be plenty of people nodding right now. Yeah. Yeah, I know that.
So, I was wearing myself very, very thin. But because of that, I had a lot of control. So, I was able to kind of plan out how I was going to tackle these things. And I think when I took on my first international client, it was kind of, well, firstly, it started with Sydney. I had a client from Sydney and I Skyped with them.
First. So, how did you find the clients? Like,
they contacted me.
How? How did they find out about
thing.
You?
This is where I feel extremely, extremely lucky and blessed that some wonderful person put our photos up, came to one of our shows and posted the photos on Instagram and Pinterest, which I did not have at the time. And they went viral. And it was just one of those crazy things. And those images are still floating around.
Yeah, right.
You know, our finale gown from our Swan Lake collection, which was in 2010, which is when it kind of all started to... No, sorry, 2011, started to all explode from there. It was one of the most pinned wedding dresses for the year.
Wow.
And so, I started getting emails from Sydney and then New York and LA, and I thought, how are these people... I thought it was a mistake. And so, the only logical thing I could think to do was to Skype with them because I had just come back from a year away in Italy. I was studying at the European Institute of Design and I was incredibly homesick and I was Skyping home every day. So, I was just like, oh, I'll just Skype them. And I did, and it seemed quite easy. It was like they were in the room with me. I kind of held the sketch pad up to the computer and
wow.
Then we did measurements and I got them to have a friend helping them and I guided them through. I sent them through my measurement diagrams and stuff. And it just worked.
That must have been a big, big thing for them too, I imagine.
Yeah.
Doing it that way back then, because that's, you know, 8 or 9 years ago now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, my daughter's got married last year. She chose a local designer here for a wedding dress, you know, fittings and all those sorts of things. That's a big call to have somebody not in the room with you.
Yeah. And I said that to them, but they were very keen on this dress.
Yeah.
And so, I said, okay, if you're sure, then let's do it. And then, after it started, it worked amazingly and it fit her beautifully and she sent photos and she was so happy with it. More and more people, then, you know, her friends were at the wedding and they wanted a dress and then it was a snowball effect. And now, we've got it down to a fine art and thankfully, you know, pattern making and fitting is something that is my area of expertise and something that I really am passionate about and I love. And again, is the whole purpose of the brand is to create garments for people that fit them like a second skin. So, that's first and foremost our number one priority. So, knowing that process works for us and we can make it work, then I think we can do anything.
Yeah, wow.
And it's just really as long as the clients have faith in us, which they do. You know, I don't want to make a dress an ugly dress and I don't want to make something that someone's not happy with and something that I'm not happy with. So, I'm when I'm consulting with any client, whether they be overseas or in the studio with me, because people do fly down as well, but Skype is just an option that we give them.
And why do they fly down? Is that because you talked before about the experience?
Yeah, they want that experience. They want to come into the atelier. They want to have the fittings and the consults. And, you know, regardless of whether they're in-house or on Skype, I treat my clients exactly the same. And regardless of their royalty or if they're not royalty, whoever they are treated with the utmost care and respect. But also, I guess I'm very personable with them and I'm a very relaxed person, I think. They just feel at home here, really.
So, you've now built an organization. It's not just you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You've got some people working for you.
Yeah.
How do you build that ethos through your company?
I think starting out, it wasn't even something that I was conscious of. Mm-hmm. Because I had no, this is my first job. I've never worked anywhere before. I didn't have any, I started Paolo Sebastian when I was 17, so fresh out of high school. My experience is year 12 business studies and the business plan that I wrote for that. Obviously, the business plan has since changed and grown and all of that, but it wasn't, you know, working culture and things like that. Throughout the staff, and that wasn't something that I initially thought of. It was just something that kind of grew organically. And I suppose our culture here is very different to a lot of other businesses. It's very much like a family, because that's, I guess, the type of person I am, and that's the way that I wanted to run the business. I wanted it to be fun, and I wanted it to be, I wanted people to be passionate about their work and care about what they're doing and what they're making. You know, there's can be times where there is a lot of pressure when we've got a show coming up or whatever it is, but everyone kind of rallies together and gets behind it. And they're not just there soullessly working, because you have to put your heart and soul into everything that you're making. And so, I feel that we've created a really... And it's something that we work on now, because I guess we're a bit more conscious of it now, but it's something that we kind of work to preserve and keep going and foster that kind of... team environment.
And do you think that plays out in your engagements of your team with your customers? If I asked your customers, would they say, yeah, we feel a bit like part of the family?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, because like a lot of the times, like when we have the fittings, a lot of the staff will come up and they'll see.
Yeah.
And just the look on the client's face, they turn around and they thank all the staff, because they're the ones that have slaved over these dresses. You know, I remember when I hired my first staff member, was kind of like biggest, hardest decision I have ever had to make, because at that point, I think I've relinquished a lot of that, but I was very much a control freak, because it was this thing, this baby that I had built. And I thought, no one is going to be able to do the sewing the way that I do it. And how do I trust and all these things? So then it was taking that leap of faith and then training this person and then realizing that's actually...
It's okay.
Yeah. I can hire another person now. Yeah. And no, it's actually quite nice, because I got some time to sleep.
But it's a big step, both in terms of cost, because you're putting on a full-time employee, right? That's a big jump for most businesses.
Yeah, yeah.
But that control piece, and more importantly, that will they do it as good as I will do it, because I'm so passionate and invested in the brand and the customers, is a massive step.
Yeah. And, you know, in some cases, they're not going to do it the same way, but you have to train. I think we've realized that quite a while ago now, though. And regardless of how talented you are or what background you have or the skills that you have, when you walk through that door, you are fresh and you will learn our way. It's great if you've got that background knowledge and that, and we love taking on board new ideas and things, but we try and make sure that everyone is to the same standard and working. And the training probably takes about a good 6 to 8 months here.
Despite their background, despite whether they've come from, you know, deep experience in industry or not.
Because look, what we're doing here is couture. It's the highest, absolute high level of sewing. The techniques, the processes that we do to create these gowns aren't what's taught here in Australia. It's not what is even seen here in Australia, and it's not even what's seen in some places in Europe. It's the high level. So, regardless of whatever you've learnt before, great if you've got some background knowledge, but our processes are different and much more time consuming and much more painstaking and laborious, but it is what gives the garments the unique hand finish.
That's what sets you apart.
Yeah.
And that makes it even more difficult in terms of handing over control, doesn't it? Because you're trying to maintain such a high standard compared to everybody else.
Absolutely. Mm. And I think because, again, the quality is absolute paramount. But now, because we have quality control in place and all these things, and people and the team is in a really good space now, that when there's enough of them, that when a new person comes in, they're able to be trained by a number of people. Whereas before, when it was just me having to sit and try and train, it was tiring and it was hard and it probably took a lot longer. But now because they're like immersed in it and everyone's on the same page. And, you know, things still continue to change and grow and we're always finding new and better ways. And each dress and each collection presents its own set of challenges. And there's always a new way to, a better way to do something based on that design. So, that there are no rules, which is kind of cool as well.
So, explain to listeners who perhaps don't understand your industry. You obviously create designs bespoke for customers, but then you also have, I think, two shows a year where you design for a particular show.
The industry as a whole, you can kind of look at it as a pyramid. And at the very top, you have haute couture, which is your, like, Dior, Chanel, those types of brands. At present, there's around only 13 houses that are officiated in haute couture.
So, is that a recognized certification or it's just what generally?
Yes. Yeah. Recognized certification in Paris that, you know, there's... And then you have your... There's different levels to it. So, there's your full accredited members and then you've got your, you know, your invited members. So, I think all up in haute couture showing during Paris or haute couture fashion week... On schedule is about 25.
Okay.
At the most, it kind of changes season to season, but it's about 25.
And are they only based in Paris or are there-
No. So, it depends on the level. So, the true haute couture is your Dior and Chanel. They are French brands and they are made completely in Paris. Then you have your other designers like Valentino that are haute couture brands, but they are made in Rome and then they showcase in Paris and parts are done in Paris. So it's the different levels. My dream and my dream for the brand has always been to reach haute couture. And that's kind of when I used to say that at around age 14, 15, people would go, okay, sure thing.
Sure.
Where we fall into it, where we are in couture. So that is the level below that, I guess. And they're the brands that are doing the custom made garments. So, anything that is haute couture or couture is you still have a fashion show, you have a seat. It's kind of the very start of the fashion calendar. The collection is shown. From there, the clients can order that piece.
From that collection.
From that collection. Shown? But that piece will then be made for you and then no one else. So, it's about exclusivity. It's about craftsmanship. It's about quality. Right. So, it's a very particular sort of process so that you're not going to a party and another woman is wearing the same gown as you. You don't have to worry about that because you've got the only one. So, they are like pieces of art. Then, beneath that, you have your alta moda high fashion, which is still your very luxury, but maybe it's tailored to you, but it's not custom made for you.
So, the design's not you.
Yeah. You're not able to say, oh, can I change the sleeve? Can I change the color? It doesn't have those, that customization. And then you have your high fashion ready to wear. That's your big designer label still, but they are purchased from the store. And then you have this sort of trickle down effect of your ready to wear and your fast fashion after that. So, we are kind of aiming, I guess, for the very top.
Absolutely.
Which is very ambitious, I know. But again, like I said, it's wanting to be a part of that idea of supporting quality and craftsmanship in an art form because that's how I see it. That's how I see fashion. So,
so I imagine the shows are pretty big for you every year, both in terms of importance, but also in terms of workload.
Yes. Incredible. The shows are important because there's the saying, you're only as good as your last collection.
Yeah.
So, with that comes a huge amount of pressure, like you cannot believe. Particularly, I think it's gotten worse as the brand has grown and as the staff numbers have grown, I feel the pressure because I have to make sure that, you know, the designs are popular and people want to wear them because if people don't want to wear them and buy them, there is no brand and there is no need for us. So, whereas I think when I was starting out, I didn't have to think or worry about, and I try not to worry about it too much, but because I think that kind of can stifle the creativity, but the reality is it's there in the back of your mind. But then the workload it's insane because you have to do your clients and your regular work, but then also you've got this show on top of it.
Mm.
And I'm very much a perfectionist and I'm not just worried about the clothes. I'm worried about how the models walk and the shoes and how the hair is going to sit and what makeup. Are we having 3 eyelashes on the end or 4 eyelashes on the end? What song and what's the music? What's the order? I'll probably sit and help mix the music myself. And I've got the running order and all these things and what's the booklet that's sitting on the seat? Oh, I don't trust anyone to do that. I'll do the artwork for that and I'll go to the printer and get it done. I've got my team here to help me, but you know, these are the, are we going with this shade of blue or that shade of blue for the booklet? It's, there is a lot of work. It's basically like having a wedding every 6 months with 20 or 30 brides because that's honestly how in-depth it is.
Now I'm freaking out. I went through one of those in September. I understand what goes involved. That's the amount of, I get it.
Yeah. Like my friend's getting married at the moment and I kind of just look at it. I'm like, this is almost a piece of cake compared to a fashion show because you've just got one person you have to, and the bridesmaids, but that's easy.
So, do you get to an end of a show with that level of involvement and go, yeah, I did it? Or do you always walk away going, I could do something better?
Yeah, you're never, I don't think I've ever walked away, bar once, sort of, I'd say 90% happy. And it's not that you're unhappy. It's a weird thing. It's not dissatisfaction. It's just knowing that there's always something better, always something that you can improve on, which is also a good feeling because it drives you to keep going. The one that I would say I've walked away from and just been really content and happy with was our Disney collection. That was a collaboration that we did with Disney. And that is more a sentimental thing for me, because I'm a huge Disney fan. So I kind of walked away from that show, although there were definitely a million things I would want to change and I wish I could do it over again. Just so I could make it absolutely perfect, but it was still perfect. And, I loved everything. Every second of that experience. And even though it was at times stressful and really hard because I wanted it to be perfect, not just for me, but for the people that were seeing it, it was just such an enjoyable experience. Mm-hmm. And I wish I could do that collection and that show every season because it was so much fun. But also fashion has to keep moving forward and we have to keep moving forward.
As do we all. So where does your personal validation come from? Does it come from the design process? Does it come from, you know, the outcome that you see or the client feedback or the stuff? Where does it come from?
The smallest things. You know, the look on a client's face when they put the dress on.
Yeah, I bet.
Just seeing the fit of the waist and the corset. Like, you know, when you've got something and it just fits perfectly, I'm happy. And all I can do is stare at it. Or a client walking around in a dress and you're just seeing how it flows and just the movement of the fabric. I'm very much in, like I said, I love Disney, I love animation, all those things. So I love movement. I love seeing how fabric moves. So just that for me, seeing like if you've got a nice chiffon skirt or a georgette skirt and seeing how that's flowing and moving. I love that. I love going into the sewing room and seeing the girls do something on the mannequin and it's perfect when something is perfect and seeing their satisfaction and my satisfaction like that. Hearing client feedback as well. It's the smallest things, you know, some days driving past the studio and going, that's my studio. That's pretty cool. Or watching one of the shows back might be months later and just seeing it and going, it's kind of like an out of body sort of thing and you're watching it as someone else. It's very strange.
I mean, your designs are obviously on quite famous people. You've had
Heidi Klum and
Academy Awards, and in fact, I think that's tonight, isn't it?
Yeah, we didn't get any today. No, that's not right.
But in the past, you've had Academy Awards, and you see quite famous people.
Yeah,
that must be a huge sense of satisfaction. But when it's on the other side of the world, do you still watch it as
there's sort of a disconnect. And you kind of sometimes look at it as, I remember when we were making that, but then you also look at it as Heidi Klum's wearing our dress.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah.
Or Heidi Klum looks great.
Yeah.
Oh, it's our dress.
That's because of us. We helped with that. I mean, which is naturally pretty great anyway,
she's
right?
She's pretty good by herself. It's a very, I can't even put it into words. It's a very strange and surreal feeling. And even walking out at the end of a fashion show, And taking the bow and people are crying and cheering and clapping and you know, friends and family are in that and they were at the first show and they were in my parents' lounge room when I was making dress, you know, so that they have been there from the beginning and to kind of get to where we are now, it's just a very surreal, strange and wonderful experience. Mm. I don't know how to put it into words, but it's humbling and, I don't know. I'm always taken back, I think, to those early days. And I think that the thought of that and the dreams and the aspirations I had then are still so strong today. And that's kind of what propels me forward.
I meant to ask you about your early days. Where does the name Paolo Sebastian come from?
I get asked this all the time. It's such a mystery for people. So, Paolo is just Paul.
In Italian, yeah.
Yeah, and Sebastian's my middle name.
Oh, there you go.
It's so simple. I came up with the name when I was 12. And it was like, should I call it this or should I call it that? And my friends have said, oh, no, Paolo Sebastian sounds good. Yeah, go with that.
Yeah, go with that. Good, done. Yeah, it's available.
Yeah, great. Done, tick. And then, and the logo I came up with in year 11 IP design. And, no, it was art and design. And I remember printing off all these different fonts and then tweaking some. And I just went around the classroom and got people to put a vote on which one. And that one won. So, that's the one we went
for,
with.
For all your year 11 students out there, school is useful.
Yeah, school is very – well, I used – I mean, every single subject I used to kind of build the brand.
Wow.
And, you know, like I said, the business studies assignment and English, we had to do a report. I did a report on Paolo Sebastian. Art, we had to create catalog. I did Paolo Sebastian's catalog. I did the logo for Paolo Sebastian. So, I left year 12 at CBC and I was good to go.
Ready to go. Yeah, brilliant.
In fact, it was halfway through year 12 because I launched Paolo Sebastian as a part of my year 12 extension studies assignment.
Right.
That was in July of 2007. And I got a full page in the newspaper the next day from that show. And
so, what does launch mean?
I had always been going on about wanting to be a fashion designer and wanting to start my own label. One of my teachers came up to me when we were doing the subject selections and she said, there's a subject that you can do, which is basically a plan your own topic. You can do whatever you want. I think you should have a fashion show. I thought, okay, cool. And I knew nothing about what it took to put on a fashion show, what it involved. I just knew it was something I really had to do and wanted to do. And so, I went about organizing it. We were raising money for Canteen, the cancer charity.
Mm-hmm.
I had all my friends that I had made dresses for over the years, school formal dresses and things. And at that time, I wasn't charging anyone for sewing or, you know, making dresses or anything. So, I called in all the favors. They all had to model for me in the show. So, I didn't have to worry about models. And I began making a collection. And I thought we'd be maybe lucky to get 100 people rock up to this show. And I actually was really scared because I remember going to see the venue for the first time and it was so big. And I thought, this is going to be an embarrassment. I'm going to be a joke, a laughing stock. I thought, oh, it's too late to back down now. We just have to run with it. And my friends, mums, everyone, they were all there helping sewing buttons on and doing hems the week before. And on the night, we ended up having 660 people turn up.
Oh, my goodness.
We had a line down the street of people because we had sold tickets because it was to raise money. But then we had extra people just turn up on the night. So, I think we had sold around 500 or so, and then, you know, more came on the night. People were standing up at the back, like you couldn't move. It was packed. And yeah, we got a full page in color in the advertiser the next day. And it was born from then. I had wedding dress orders starting to come through and I still had half of my exams to study for. Because I promised my parents, I said, after this show, I will focus on the rest of my subjects. And because I had exams and I had all that. And I think they were a little bit concerned that I was going to fail because I devoted everything to this show.
Yeah.
But it all worked out really well. I didn't fail.
I imagine there's people who've been to that show and said, I was there.
A lot of people still say that to me.
I was there at that first show and look what it's become now. So, you talked before about perfectionism, which is not uncommon in people who start their own businesses. Yours is probably at the extreme end of the spectrum.
Yes.
And your product and your business shows that. How do you not burn staff out along the way driving that perfectionism through your business? Because not every staff member can work with that.
No.
How does that not happen in your business? Or has it happened?
I think because to want to work in this industry, you have to be somewhat of a perfectionist yourself. And so, everyone that works here, they want to do the best job because they can see the type of work going on around them and no one wants to let the team down. So, everyone is 100% devoted to that. The issue is time and that's where it can get – you can burn out and you can get tired and
– Because of the amount of hours that you're putting in or
because, just because I guess the – you have to do something that maybe in some cases would take you a week to do, and you've only got a couple of days to do it. So it's that pressure. But the really good ideas come at the last minute.
Is that right?
And okay. I don't know why. It's like a cruel joke.
is that the build upon? So you've got an idea, and then something else comes, and then you build upon that, and then eventually, right? You've got all of this stuff that sits in the background of, you know, through the design process, and then. Bingo.
I think so. Like, you know, I remember one example when we were showcasing in Paris the very first year. This is back in 2016. I left here. It was like 2 a.m. and I was driving home. The collection was nearly done. And just in the car ride on the way home, a dress popped into my head. And so, I had to turn around and come back to work.
Did you?
So that I could sketch it out and, you know, put all that, because I knew exactly what fabric, because I had been working on this thing and it kind of wasn't coming together. So I scrapped the idea, but then it meant that we wouldn't have a short dress in the collection.
Right. Yeah.
And I was like, oh, it's fine. I kind of just tried to let it go. And then because I wasn't thinking about it,
wow,
it worked out, and it ended up being one of the most popular dresses in the whole collection. So, wow. Sometimes those things happen. But then, you know, in order to make that dress a reality and get that complete, it's a lot of work. So, we were actually hand sewing that dress while we were in Paris. So, it worked out great. But then, when you do have that throw in of this last minute rush, when it doesn't happen all the time, people actually get quite excited.
Yeah.
And I remember we had a dress to do for Poppy Delevingne for the NGV Gala last year in November. And it was actually such a rush. It's really strange, but it was such a rush. And we were all saying how exciting it was, because it's like, is it going to get done? And how's it going to look? And in some cases, you don't even get to see it finished on the mannequin, because you're just working to get it done. So, yes.
So, because that's not the norm.
Because it's not the norm, it becomes an exciting thing. Yes. But if it was the norm, and it was the norm for, you know, maybe back in 2015, we got to a point where that was the norm all the time. And I could see it was hard and we had to make some changes, and we did. So, and we're still going through that, you know, things can always be run better can go more smoothly. And every time you do something, you think, okay, let's put something in place so that this can be improved or that can be improved. So, we're all conscious of that. And so, I think that's just done through meetings and training days, and just so we can get everyone on the same page and people can contribute their ideas. So, if there are any issues that anyone is having, we can kind of try and combat them straight away.
I imagine running such an exciting, amazing business that has such great clients and great designs, there must be a lot of pressure or pull to bring it out of Australia into more traditional markets, you know, Milan or Paris or New York.
Yeah. I mean, I get asked all the time when I'm moving, even still, which is...
I imagine people would like to have you on their payroll and those sorts of things as well.
Yeah.
How do you resist...
Because
it's a massive boost in validation of your capability when you have, you know, those people and those fashion houses, etc., want to have you over there.
It's just not something that's part of the plan. I know in my gut where we're meant to go and where we're meant to be, and if it just doesn't feel right, I already know that it's not the right time or place or anything for us. Look, of course, I would love to have a studio or something in Paris, but we will remain based here.
Yeah.
So, regardless of, you know, of course, I want Paolo Sebastian to be a complete global brand, but the headquarters will remain here in Adelaide, because that's part of our DNA and part of our story and the reason why we exist.
Does the distance give you an advantage because you don't become wrapped up in what everyone else is doing?
Yeah, I think in some cases, it definitely has given over the years a point of difference. Because people remember, one, they remember Australia, because they go, especially in Europe, they're, wow, Australia, so far, beautiful beaches. I didn't realize that they did fashion too. And then also Adelaide, because it's a beautiful sounding name, and they maybe haven't heard, because they know of Sydney or Melbourne, but they might not necessarily know of Adelaide. So, it's kind of that discovery. And I think that's what's great about fashion is that discovering something new.
Yeah.
So, for a lot of people and a lot of clients, they feel like, especially the clients that feel like they have brought us over to, say, the Middle East, they feel that sense of discovery and that sense of connection, that there's that connection to us, I guess, that they have brought something to the community that is new. And that's exciting. And so, I think there's definitely always, I always get asked when we're going to move and when we're going to pack up and move to Paris or wherever it is. The answer to that is we won't be. We will be hopefully one day opening something there as well as, but the headquarters and the production, particularly for the couture, will remain here.
I imagine if you were a 17-year-old in Paris and you decided to start your own label, it'd be, here's another one. And I imagine that, you know, having done that here, it's given you the ability to really set your own path, your own course, and be and have that point of differentiation compared to others.
Yeah, well, I mean, look, I lived in Milan, as I said, for a year. I was 19. And although it was an amazing experience, the school was incredible, the teachers, everything about that year was amazing. But at the same time, I couldn't wait to get out of there because I was just another kid in Milan studying fashion. And every person that I met, they're like, oh, you're Australian. Let me guess, what are you doing here? You're here to study fashion or you're a model or you're a photographer?
Well, it's nice that they said you were a model.
Yeah, well, I was like, I'm definitely not a model. but that's just, you know, what people assume. And it is hard. And even Sydney and Melbourne, it's there are so many people competing to do that. And it's, I guess, tiring. Whereas I can be here and I can live a relatively normal life, and feel energized and feel calm and inspired, I guess, and knowing that we're doing something that is different. And it's, yes, it's been challenging. There's certainly challenges that go with it, mainly because of distance. And also because, I guess, particularly when I started out, there wasn't much of a fashion industry here to speak of. That has since changed, thankfully. So, I guess that I think the number one challenge that I faced when I was starting out as a 17-year-old was that people didn't take you seriously just purely because you're from Adelaide.
Yeah.
And that used to make me really angry because I thought, why should it matter whether I'm from Paris or Milan or Adelaide? It doesn't mean I know any less.
It's what's in the head, right?
Yeah,
it's
design, exactly.
It's design that should be the important element.
And so, that used to frustrate me. And also, because of my age, because people would think, you know, 17 years old, what do you know? But also, I had started studying pattern making drafting from the age of 12, younger. I was sewing from age 3. So, I had a lot of experience when I was 17. I had already years and years worth of experience. And so, that used to kind of be one of the hurdles that I faced as a really young designer.
I love the fact that you had two major things batting against you, really, in terms of your age and your location. I imagine there's plenty of people looking now going, should have taken some notice. But it is that question of, well, why not?
Yeah, why, exactly.
Why not? Why can't I be successful here? Why can't I drive a great business here? Why can't I use those things to my advantage rather than use them as a disadvantage?
I think for a lot of people as well, there wasn't that blueprint. That was the other thing. It hadn't been done before. And so, that there was nothing that they could compare it to.
And that's the piece that makes me angry, right? Because really, out of no blueprint comes some great, amazing things, right? Because if we only ever stick within the blueprint, then we'll only do incremental changes, not great leaps forward.
Yeah. And because people try and give me advice, they really couldn't because there was nothing that they could go by because no one was doing couture. And they would give me advice maybe that suited someone who was in fast fashion or ready to wear. And they would say, you know, you have to go to Sydney and you have to do this and you have to do that. And like, hang on a minute, that is really nothing about the couture industry at all. And because people weren't educated on couture, they would see me not following their advice and get frustrated with that wonder why I was doing what I was doing and the way I was doing it. But I knew that it was right for my industry. And so, that it was just kind of constant, like in the beginning, but just butting heads. And even with my style was very romantic and nostalgic and, I guess, pretty. I want to make beautiful things. I want to make things that look nice. That was an issue for a lot of people as well, because they're like, it's not edgy enough. It's not modern enough. It's not this. It's not that. That's fine. There are other brands that are doing those things. We're different because of this. And so, it was just that constant battle, I think, initially to kind of just prove that I was on the right path or I knew what I was doing.
Mm. One of the things many organizations face the challenge of when designing something new is staying true to the design that they've, you know, come up with and mm-hmm. iterated with versus taking feedback from clients.
Yeah.
Where does that fit for you? Do the designs come first? Do the client feedback come first? Do they work with each other?
When it's collection is pretty much solely my ideas and inspiration. Obviously, you know, I work with on it with the team, but and I'll ask for their feedback. And we have to take into consideration construction and all those things. But essentially, collections are purely me.
And does the inspiration come entirely from within? Or
it
are you
can
taking
be from anywhere.
From anywhere? From
like, and each seat, you know, we have to come up with two a year. And look, some brands, they do 12 a year or more. Yeah. So, so we've done a lot of different things. It can be from art. It can be from music. Like, we just did The Nutcracker, which was inspired by the score that Tchaikovsky wrote for the ballet. The season before that, we did Disney, which was everything that I loved as a child put into one collection. We've done The Snow Maiden, which was a story that we adapted. We've done Reverie, which was a collection inspired by the work of Alphonse Mucha, who's an artist. He kind of developed the way for Art Nouveau. We just did The Starlet, which is kind of inspired by old Hollywood and the stories of Hedy Lamarr and Betty Davis and Joan Crawford and Judy Garland. So, researching their lives and everything. So, it can really be from anywhere, history, anywhere. So, that, though, can be very daunting. And I think the most scary part is deciding on a theme.
Right.
Because if that idea doesn't work or doesn't translate to an audience, your collection has already failed. That's scary. But then, when you're working with a client, I guess it's a collaboration between you and the client. So, particularly, you know, we do a lot of wedding gowns. Yeah, I think for a lot of evening wear, a lot of people tend to adapt from the collection. But with bridal gowns, it's sometimes you're creating something completely new from scratch. And you're not even looking at any embroideries or colors or anything from that has been seen in the collections. So, it's really kind of working with them, firstly, to work out what fit and shape is going to best look on them and highlight their figure. And that in itself can sometimes be an educational process, because if the client has never had anything made for them before, it's kind of explaining it's a different process. It's a slower process. Yeah. If they're not used to that, particularly the clients overseas, though, maybe they've had a bit more experience in couture. So they get it and they understand how it works and they know that this takes time or this is how that works. But it's fittings, and the design will grow and evolve and change throughout the process. And it all starts with a sketch, really. So it's I guess getting to know them, the client, and understanding their needs and their inspiration and their wants and their desires, and then being able to put that and their personality into a design and something that also represents us, that we can be proud of.
So, outside of the design theme or the design element for the show, which sounds like it's a pretty scary process, worrying process, I suppose.
Yeah, more worrying,
To get it right. What else in building and growing a business has challenged you along the way?
I think the thing that challenges me the most probably is that I've never felt that I am a natural boss. If that makes sense.
So, what does a natural boss look like?
I don't know. I think because I'm a very creative person, I'm not necessarily a very organized person in the sense that, I mean, it's creative organization and creative chaos. But, you know, I remember the first time I sat down with the accountants and my head was spinning and it kind of just all... I've gotten better at it over the years and understanding and wrapping my head around it. But none of that stuff ever interested me in the beginning. I was like, this is so boring. I just want to design dresses.
You can't be super right brain and super left brain.
No, you can't. But I've had to be for the last couple of years. And let me tell you, it is straining because I have to walk out of one room, which I've just had a business meeting in, and then walk into it. My clients just arrived. And so, I'm sitting down and I'm sketching a dress for them. So, it's definitely been something that I've had to adapt to, but I'm actually enjoying it. And I listen to business podcasts now and read books now, and it's like, who is
this? Who is this person?
What have I become? What have I become? But I think because I see the results of that and of growing the business, I think because in the very early years, because it was just me, I didn't have to worry about meetings and all those things. But now as the business has grown, you know, we're a staff of 18 now, so I have to be a leader. And I think leading and managing people is two very different things.
Absolutely.
The leading, great. I'm happy to do that. Love that. I think it's that I think kind of sort of comes naturally to me, but the managing is not so much fun, and just organizing meetings. And I like the idea of organizing a meeting, but then when you're actually planning out and writing all the paperwork and all those things and the booklets, and when you've got to make 18 booklets, there's a lot of booklets to make.
You like making booklets. And you just need to add your creative flair.
Yeah, I've got to get them foiled and, you know, they're going to be $30 booklets by then.
Yeah, but maybe not.
I'll be worried more about the cover than what's actually in them. So, that I think has been hard. But then I also try to make it fun as well, because when we will have a business meeting, I might also tack on a fashion history lesson to that with the staff. So, we're doing something fun as well as educational.
Are you worried about a time where the business grows so big that that's your life and you've lost the creative client element?
Sometimes, having spoken with people who are doing very well and, or, you know, people from Vogue and things, and they talk about how stressed other designers are. And I think I don't want to lose the passion. So, that's, I guess, a little bit of a fear that's always there. But I think because I'm very restrained and I know my limits, and if something is getting too much, I'll step back and focus on what is important to me, and I won't let, I don't know, the silly business things kind of worry me. And I've got a very good team around me that are here to support me and support the business, and they'll also jump in when it is getting too much, and they'll kind of try and help share the load. And
we've got to remember why you always started this business, and you didn't start so you could become a great meeting organizer and put great booklets for meetings together.
No.
And that's not why you started.
No, exactly. And I'm most used to the business when I'm designing.
Mm.
And that's just what I try and keep reminding myself. And at the point that we're at, the reality is I have to do some of both.
Yeah.
And I just have to get over that and suck it up and just get on with it, because there's no time for me to sit in the corner and have a freak out about it, because that's not going to get anyone anywhere. So, I have to come up with the designs, and then I also have to run a business, and that's just that.
And it's
my business at the end of the day. But I do have a great support team, and you know, I will lean on them when I need to. And they're always there for me, and I'm so grateful for that.
Yeah,
and
good.
They have been wonderful, and that's the only reason the business has been able to grow, is because I have them behind me to help me where I don't have the skills or fall down. And I think, you know, it's that same thing. Whereas if you're the smartest person in the room, you're doing the wrong thing. You need people around you that excel in areas that you don't.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, if there's someone here that's a better designer than me, then we've got an issue.
Good luck with that.
I shouldn't be doing what I'm doing.
Well, that means they're in the wrong room.
Yeah. But, you know, in terms of craftsmanship and running a business and knowing what to do and PR and all those things, I've got great people who have an understanding of that, and they know the business just as well as me, and they know what's right for the business. So, I trust them to make calls and make decisions.
Yeah.
They'll obviously consult with me, but I feel like I've built a really strong team that we're all in it together, and we're all wanting to see it succeed. And the business success is just as much their success as it is mine.
Brilliant. So, what excites you about the future?
I think the possibilities. I think anything is really possible. You know, we're not even a quarter of the way of where we need to be. I'm waiting for that day that I can be, you know, walking down the street overseas and you see Paolo Sebastian shoes in the shop window, or someone walking down the street with a Paolo Sebastian bag. That I'm excited for. I love luxury, and I love that experience, and I want people to have that experience. I want them to be excited by, you know, being able to maybe go into David Jones or wherever it is that we're sold, and go into our stores and have that that moment that I have when I go into, say, Dior or Chanel or Valentino, that exciting feeling of, I don't even know what that feeling is, but it's that sense of a dream. That's what I want to create for people. That's what I get when I look at beautiful fashion and go into stores and even just seeing the shop fit out. It's all those details and things, like the way that they present you the coffee and, you know, the spoon matches this and that, and it matches the wallpaper. It's all those little things that kind of go together that really excites me. That's what I want for my brand, and that's what I want for people to experience. So, and with that comes a lot of work, comes a lot of meetings about things. It doesn't just happen. But yeah, I think we can get there. There's definitely, I think what is great and what the past couple of years have shown is that there is a strong brand aesthetic, and there are people that respond to that aesthetic, and they want the brand, they want more of the brand, which is great. We just now have to meet the demand.
Yeah. Brilliant. It's an exciting place to be.
Yeah. So, I mean, we get asked every day, can we buy the shoes from the runway? Can we buy this ready to wear? Do you have, where are your stores? Where are this and that? So, there's the demand.
Mm.
You know, we did a collaboration with Canteen again this year.
Oh, wow.
I designed their bandana for Bandana Day, which was nice because it was kind of like just after our 10 years. And because my first show was to raise money for Canteen, they approached me and I immediately said yes. So, we designed the bandana. I ended up selling out online across Australia within like a few hours of going on sale.
Wow.
Whilst that was a great feeling, because I knew that we had raised so much money, I also thought, wow, that means the brand has such a strong pull and strong presence that if we had products like that to go up online, it would be so wonderful. Mm-hmm. So, and people were posting about these bandanas because they had a piece of Paolo Sebastian. Yeah. And the way that they were wearing them on their handbags, on their hair, all these different ways. It was so cool and people were so excited. And that's a great feeling. That's that satisfaction of this is why we do what we do.
Yeah, brilliant. Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for sharing your
Thanks
story.
Thanks for having me.
It's been a great journey. We're going to take some photos after this.
Cool.
To show our listeners that we're actually here and have a bit of a look around your wonderful place here. So, congratulations on building such a successful business.
Thank you so much and thank you for having me.
Cheers. I reckon there's a bunch of entrepreneurs out there listening to this who are nodding their heads the whole way through. Even if you're from a different industry, the challenges that Paul faced and the drive for perfection and the elements of learning to run a business will resonate with many of you. I loved the visual imagery when he was explaining what it was like to showcase for 2 fashion shows in Paris each year. It's like organizing a world-class wedding every 6 months, including making all the dresses for 20 or 30 brides. Amazing. If you want to find out more about Paul and Paolo Sebastian, I've got some great info and links in the show notes and on our website, www.theselfmadetheory.com. Until next time, keep innovating, overcoming, and prospering.